So good morning, guys. I think it's about 11:45 in the morning, and it is Thursday, the 19th of March, 2020. And you're listening to podcast number 39, which I have entitled something along the lines of On to the Higher Functions. But before we get started, I apologize for the sunglasses again, but the sun is right up here in my face and I don't want to be squinting through the whole video. I also apologize for taking a little bit longer than I normally do to get a video out. I usually try and do it every 4 weeks, but I think we're up to like 6 weeks now, or maybe even more since the last video. But as all of you should now be aware, there are big issues going on in the world in connection with this plague that is sweeping through every country, and it has meant that my job in relation to the group which I run, the Heridim Group, has been ramped up and become a bit more complicated over the last couple of months as we prepare to batten down and weather out the next probably several months or year while travel is limited, while communication will probably also become limited, and while we have a bunch of new students to ease into the process of the training that we deliver. So last couple of months have been very busy. It's not that we were not aware that this situation was going to arise, but for the most part, a bunch of things that need to be done to keep Heridim running and to make sure that it's healthy when we come out the other end of this. We couldn't really do a bunch of things until the last minute, which we're in the process of doing now. So we've taken on our last batch of students for the year, and we're in the process of moving them into tuition and assigning them with tutors now, in the hope that their training will not be interrupted over the next few months because of this illness situation. And what that also means is I can't guarantee from now until all of this kind of stabilizes, whatever getting back to normal might be like at the end of this, because I have a feeling that normal life at the other end of COVID-19 is not going to be the same as life as we've been used to it up until now. So ideally, as long as the internet remains running and that countries don't start filtering information or putting up firewalls, and as long as ISPs keep operating, then training and also uploading videos, podcasts to my channel here shouldn't be interrupted. But I also can't guarantee what my life is going to be like from here on out, because I am a chef at a retirement home, a small retirement home. And what that means is that while everybody else is being locked down and quarantined in their homes, self-quarantine, personal distancing, whatever you like to call it, I will very likely be made to continue or be required to continue to keep working all the way through this, unless it gets to the point where the residents in our retirement home get to the point where too many of them have become critical or have died because of this illness. So who really knows what's going to happen from now on. And that could seriously affect my ability to regularly produce these podcasts from now on. But all that being said and done, it is still my intention to try and get out a podcast every month. I still have tons of stuff that I want to talk about, dozens of podcasts planned for the future. So whatever the next few months brings because of this plague, I assume eventually we're going to get back into a normal rhythm of filming and uploading podcasts to the channel. So I thank everybody for their patience over the next few months who continues keeping an eye on this, because one of the big issues that we have while the peak of this problem is working its way out is to ensure that at the other end of this that we are ready to start taking on students again at the end of this year or the beginning of next year, as soon as people out there are requiring training again. And that also means, of course, that our plans for Hereditary College are probably going to be somewhat stalled. We were intending to have a launch date of the middle or towards the end of this year for the college, but that likely is not going to happen now. Although downtime that we get now because of quarantines and everything and people having to stay at home means that it gives us just a bunch more time to polish up our Hereditary College package and get everything ready for release once life starts to stabilize again. But again, as long as the internet stays up, I will be posting updates on the college progress to our newsletter for anybody who has signed up for those regular announcements from our Hereditary College website. Okay, podcast number 39. Now, because I've been very busy over the last few weeks, I haven't given this podcast a lot of thought. I don't usually write scripts or notes for these podcasts. I usually do them ad lib. And so today's podcast is going to be extremely ad lib because it's going to be completely off the cuff as I go. So I'm not even quite sure what exactly it is that I'm going to be saying for this podcast number 39. So let's see how it turns out. So up till now, in relation to the process of hermetic initiation, specifically in relation to the way Hereditum delivers the initiatory training, we've discussed two important factors about what is required before we get to the stage that I'm going to talk about today. The first factor is that in the past we've required people to have a solid background in hermetic study, and that means a lot of reading, getting involved in experimenting with different kinds of meditational or magical or alchemical practices, and hopefully having joined some kind of group or some kind of society or fraternity that trains in the mainstream in order to get experience of how a school runs and what kinds of ideas these schools have about traditional teaching in Hermeticism. It's a good idea in the past for students to have done these things because our training was not entry level. We needed people who already had a solid understanding of the philosophy, practices and theory of Hermeticism before they join. But we're slowly changing that now to provide that entry level training ourselves. Then when they started basic training, the first four levels of instruction that we provide in the inner work, that meant that they were being taught all of the rules and customs that Heridom imposes on its students as part of the training process. So how to study, the kinds of ways you need to be interacting with your tutor, how we provide information, how much time is required to be input into your study and training in order to be successful, the right kind of attitude to have, and so on and so forth. Also, the other part of this four early basic training, four stages of tuition, is that you learn all the basic protocols and techniques which are required to function in the inner world safely and effectively. All the tools, all the processes, and the protocols that are required for you to function in the inner environment safely and effectively. That is the main part of basic training, which is the first four stages of training for a new student. For a tutor, it's slightly different. Tutors already have gone through that whole process, so there's nothing there which is going to be overly, in the most cases, nothing there which is going to be overly surprising or new to them as far as teaching the student. But for the tutor in the basic training, a lot is revealed from the student's exercises which can inform the teacher or the tutor about the mindset and state of the psychology of the student, which is very important, because in order to succeed in initiatory training, there are a bunch of things where personal psychology is concerned that a student needs to already have developed in their character in order to succeed. And so the tutor is watching during that basic training period for all the signs that will tell him how, basically, how psychologically mature that student is. So by the end of those first four stages, first four levels of basic training, the tutor is going to make an assessment about the suitability of the student for advanced training. So this is basically the fifth level all the way up to roughly about the end of the eighth level, and that's what we're going to sort of closely look at today. So the fifth and sixth level I have also talked about in reference to the process which helps us deal with the Nakash, the archetype which in Kabbalah is referred to as the Nakash. If you're new to these podcasts and you don't understand basic Kabbalistic technical terminology, you need to go back and have a look at the podcast early on that I made about the Partsufim, or the psychological archetypes from a Kabbalistic point of view, and have a look at what I have to say about Nakash. So, fifth and sixth level focus almost entirely on dealing with the Nakash, and most of what happens at that level is still, for the most part, a part of the secret knowledge that is still held by advanced hermetists and alchemists, people who are doing the inner work authentically. The fifth and sixth stage of our training cover dealing with the Nakash, and that is still largely secret information. Like, you're not really going to read anywhere any of the essential details about what happens at the fifth and sixth levels of our training. But if you do not succeed in completing the sixth level successfully, it's absolutely pointless trying to go any further after that stage into the advanced work, because nothing will work properly. And the reason for this is that the Nakash is kind of like a filter in the mind, where if you take, for example, the consideration in very simplified form that the psyche is divided into higher functions, which are kind of like the spiritual part of the mind, and lower functions, which are like the part of the mind or the psyche which manages our incarnate everyday personality, the Nakash kind of forms a barrier between the higher functions and the lower functions and filters everything that comes down from the higher into the lower. So that if you make, as an average mainstream occultist, if you make attempts to access the higher functions and try to get accurate information from them, as you poke your awareness into the higher function level of activity in order to communicate with the higher functions and capture information, that attempt at focusing your attention into the higher functions has got to move through that Nakash barrier. But that barrier in the average person who hasn't been initiated properly still stays intact and still filters everything that you receive from the higher functions. And that filter works in a couple of ways. The first and most simple way is that Nakash will actually block information like a firewall on a computer, where it will stop all or part of communications from being realized by conscious awareness, which is part of the lower functions, and also of being assessed by the lower functions accurately. The second way that Nakash messes with information is that it screws with the lower functions' ability to look at higher function information and assess it. Think about it and think, oh, that means X, Y, and Z. When you have to use your lower functions to think about your higher functions, that thinking process, your ability to analyze what has been happening, is always filtered by Nakash. And Nakash's reason for existence, almost, or a major part of its function, is to stop anybody who has not been initiated properly from activating the initiation process inside of themselves. So Nakash is one of the main parts of Nakash's job is to do anything to sabotage personal attempts at trying to succeed in initiation. Nakash only allows initiation to succeed when the process is being delivered according to natural law and traditional customs and rules. Now, most people don't want to believe that this is the case, and I discuss that in the Nakash initiation podcast just previously before this in some detail. So in order for us to be able to get ourselves into a situation where we can interact with our higher functions successfully, access them first, then get information out of them, and then to accurately be able to analyze and assess that information without distorting it, we first have to deal with Nakash, the filter. And so this is what that previous podcast about the guardian on the threshold is all about. It's talking about the process which is required in order to tweak the filter which manages the transfer of information from the higher functions down into the lower functions. If we don't perform that tweak first and succeed in doing it, no matter how well we believe that we are accessing our higher functions and getting accurate information and accurately understanding that information, it's still being screwed with. And Nakash is extremely cunning at being able to convince people that without performing any kind of tweak or fix at all on the filter, that they are accessing the higher functions and getting accurate information. That's part of the way Nakash operates, is to lull you into a false sense of security that without any proper initiation at all, you're actually functioning as an advanced occultist effectively. So as long as you believe that rubbish, as long as you believe that, hey, no matter what Ruba says, I've busted through the filter and accessed the higher functions and I know what's going on, no matter what Ruba says about that, I have actually succeeded in it without any kind of authentic, proper initiation at all. Tons of people attempt that very situation and convince themselves that self-initiation is real and that what I'm saying about the Guardian is not real, but which is just me exaggerating or trying to create a situation where I'm offering a kind of an elitist view of esoteric initiation or something like that. You can't have it unless you get it properly, blah blah blah. Well, no matter what you think about what I say, if the Nakash is not tweaked properly, you will end up in a situation, if you're attempting to communicate with the higher functions, which is very cunningly sabotaging that information and the way you understand it. So at the sixth level of our training, which is more or less halfway through our training, that's what that process is about: overcoming the Nakash's natural task or job or desire to sabotage communication with the higher functions. Because the very next stage in training, which is basically level 7 all the way through to the end of level 8, is all about tuning the connection with your higher functions and with higher existing intelligences of the extreme kind. So we've ideally been trained by an authentic adept, an expert who has gone through initiation themselves, who understands that process and therefore can deliver the fix on the Nakash or the Guardian on the threshold for you. And as soon as that has been successful, what that allows us to do then is accurately access the higher functions. So when I say access the higher functions, we are basically talking about three categories of entity, of living beings. The first category is your personal higher functions, your neshama, your chia, and your yakida. That's the first level and most personal level of what we refer to as higher functions. The next level is contacting intelligences or entities or individuals in the sidereal universe, in the Esosphere, who already have advanced way past the stage that you're at that level 7 training. You've completed dealing with the Guardian on the threshold, you've successfully tweaked it, and above you are a whole range of entities, intelligences, who have already gone way past that point. And some of those intelligences exist to aid individuals who are moving past that Guardian on the threshold stage of training up to knowledge and conversation with the higher genius. So what we're saying is that there are like spiritual guides, to use a very popular term, which isn't inaccurate. They are like spiritual guides, but we in Heridim refer to them as the inner teacher. Your first teacher in initiation is a physical person who you know and communicate through some kind of physical medium. Either you know them face to face, or you're communicating with them over the internet or by correspondence or something, and they are taking you from being a normal person, whether you think you're already a smart ass student of the occult or not. You enter real training as a normal person, because you don't really know what's going to be happening to you or what real initiation is about anyway, and takes you up to the point of having successfully dealt with the Guardian on the threshold. That's the physical teacher's primary job. His next, very next job is to introduce you to one of these inner teachers. An entity, an intelligence, or an individual who is actually independent of you. They have their own independent existence, however that might actually be in their reality. But the important thing is that the student can communicate with that inner teacher through the interior landscape, through the Esosphere or the sidereal universe or the magical universe. In other words, technically speaking, once the sixth level of training of dealing with the Guardian on the threshold is complete, one of the skills that the student has developed is internal telepathy, which allows them to communicate with other living sovereign entities telepathically and internally, and obtain accurate tuition from that entity. So that's the first stage at the seventh level of training. The first thing that the seventh level of training is going to deliver is a special process that allows the student to access the inner teacher and formally form a relationship with that individual, so that from that point on, that individual becomes the primary teacher, especially where all internal mechanics are concerned. Because the skill that all internal teachers have is that they understand that internal environment and exactly what is required to operate in that environment safely and effectively. And that's what they'll start doing while you're working through the seventh level, and then most importantly the eighth level, which actually is composed of 7 exercises. The eighth level is 7 different exercises in our system. While the student is working through that chunk of the training, the inner teacher is trying to kit out the student with all of the proper, safe and effective behaviours that are required to operate at the next standard of level in the inner environment. The physical teacher could actually teach that part of the process, but the benefit of the internal teacher is that the internal teacher actually has a face-to-face and intimate interaction with the student's internal machinery. That inner teacher can look at you psychically and understand what needs to be tweaked in you in order to get you to function effectively in the internal environment. So that relationship begins at the seventh level of instruction, and then the eighth level of instruction, which is divided into seven important exercises, provides a number of opportunities for developing all kinds of advanced, let's say, psychic functions in the student. So the first two types of psychic intelligence, spiritual guide, higher function entities are your own higher functions, Neshama, Chia, and Yakita, plus the inner teacher, who is already an advanced spiritual being of some kind in its own reality. It has already been through all of the initiatory training and been successful, and now one of the jobs he has is helping up and coming students. And the third type of higher functioning being are archetypes from the collective unconscious, which are referred to in the mainstream tradition by the common terminology of spiritual beings or angelic beings and God forms or divine powers or the blind forces of nature. In human psychology, they're basically referred to as psychological archetypes. They are patterns of behavior that exist at the very root of the collective human awareness. They are beyond dysfunction, and therefore they have a very powerful influence on the psyche when you interact with them internally in the internal environment. Your personal higher functions, the inner teacher, and archetypes from the collective unconscious. Now that we've dealt with the guardian on the threshold, and we can have a relatively accurate access to the higher function level of the human psyche, the first thing we want to be doing is immediately making intimate connections with these higher functions, because they have a supercharged beneficial effect on the human psyche. As long as that human psyche has already been properly prepared in order to safely interact with these higher forces. If you haven't already been properly prepared to interact safely with these higher forces, when you attempt to interact with them, these higher forces have no morality or set of ethics similar to the kind of things that we would consider from normal everyday people. So for example, these higher forces are like electricity. Electric power provides humanity with enormous benefits. It runs all of our trinkets. We can mix cakes with it. We can cut sandwiches with it, we can light our homes with it, but we can also electrocute criminals with it. We can kill people with electricity. We can use it to power and aim weapons of mass destruction, for example. The electricity has no moral or ethical code, no attitude about what it's being used for. Like a kitchen knife that can be used to peel an apple or stab somebody to death, electricity does not care about what it's used for. And the higher functions are exactly the same. If you plug yourself in to the power that is the higher functions, and you still have dysfunctional complexes in your own psyche, what will happen is that higher energy, like electricity, will fuel everything inside your system, supercharge it, which means that your dysfunctional behaviors, while you may have been just slightly aware of them before, or in a management level with your dysfunctional behaviors before, once you plug yourself into the higher functions without safe preparation, those higher functions are going to supercharge your dysfunctional behaviors and they're going to blow your system out. This is how most people in the popular level or mainstream level of esoteric practice get themselves in trouble. They don't have that safety mechanism of dealing with the guardian on the threshold first in order to fix their dysfunctional behavior, so that when they plug themselves into the supercharged level of reality, it doesn't blow out their system. People who have authentic training also have access to somebody who has already been through all of this with their own teacher. And so if and when you do get yourself into trouble, when you start slowly jacking yourself into the higher functions, easing yourself into that, you have a teacher there who knows how to deal with all that stuff, who can advise you absolutely expertly on what you need to do in order to not have those, that higher function effect, blow out your circuits. This is completely real. Anybody who doesn't think this real and thinks I'm exaggerating or making this stuff up or that it's just a theory, you'll get yourself into trouble if you try to apply the kinds of things that I'm discussing here without proper training. These things are real. I see them every day. Every single day, I am working with a number of people who are in advanced training, who are wrestling, who are absolutely struggling with dealing with all of this stuff, with shifting themselves from lower function behavior, normal person world, into dealing with plugging themselves into that higher function power, making that switch over to the point where they have access to that higher function power, but it's not destroying their life. Okay, so that is what level 8 is primarily designed to do. Level 8 in our training exposes you to the influence of the inner teacher in instructing you how to deal with higher function access, and it also has an aspect where you're being introduced to archetypes from the collective human unconscious, which is bringing a massive influx of power into your psyche and therefore into your physical body as well, because your psyche is the pattern for your physical body, and everything moves from the top down. Everything flows downwards from the mind into the body. Whatever's happening in the mind affects the body. And this is one of the reasons why we perform initiation. We fix the mind, and the mind affects the body in a new kind of a way and transforms you completely. This is a holistic system. It's not just dealing with one thing over there in order to be able to mess with reality effectively or something. It's changing everything on every level. So in level 7 of training, you're introduced to your inner teacher, and that requires a special format, a special protocol. Not just anybody can get access to that situation, because the inner teacher belongs to an organization, for want of a better term, of inner teachers who all use the same system in order to train up-and-coming initiates. And though that organization of inner teachers or spiritual guides or whatever you want to call them, one of the offices that they possess is that they have a lot of control over your psyche as their student. And part of that control is that they can vet who gets access to them and who doesn't. And they have rules about that, and they stick to those rules. So largely, but not completely, largely these inner teachers will not even talk to anybody who attempts to get to them by themselves without proper initiation. There's no point. If you've not dealt with the guardian on the threshold properly, there's no point in them communicating with you, because they know that you can't pass their information properly. Pass as in computer language, P-A-R-S-E. You can't pass their communication properly. So there's no, if you haven't dealt with the guardian on the threshold, so there's no point in them even bothering communicating with you, because you're not tuned in. So they set up a situation in the side real universe where people who have had proper training know how to get proper access to them. And this is how they vet the people that they help, the people who they establish intimate relationships with. Now also, because they have a lot of control over your psyche as their student, and they need to have that control because they need to see what's dysfunctional in you in order to be able to present you with accurate and effective instruction to help you fix yourself. Because they have this control over your psyche, in level 8 of the training process, where you're supposed to be learning from the inner teacher and carrying out the inner teacher's instructions, and where you're interacting with archetypes from the collective human unconscious as the higher, the biggest higher function power source, so that you can practice being exposed to that source of power and learn from your inner teacher how to tweak yourself in order to manage that properly. If during the 8th level of training you are not carrying out all of that instruction according to protocol safely and effectively, the first thing that's going to happen there is that the inner teacher will start making changes in the internal environment that we use in order to interact with these spiritual intelligences. There's a particular environment that we operate in, and it always appears in the same way, but it's also flexible so that it can talk to you about what's happening in your psyche and in the collective unconscious around you. So if you misbehave, if you don't carry out the inner teacher's instructions properly, or if you do not continue to use the operating protocols that your outer teacher taught you in basic training, what happens is the inner teacher starts to signal the outer teacher through the student's session work, inner work exercises. Signs start popping up that the teacher will notice as being indicators that something is not going right here. That no matter what the student is telling me, there is something else going on. So maybe they're censoring their inner work exercise reports, or they're exaggerating certain aspects of what's happening in their inner sessions, or they're lying about certain things that are happening or not happening in their inner work exercises. And so they're not playing the game properly, they're not being safe, and they're not doing what's required to be effective. The inner teacher will recognize this and signal the outer teacher, at which point, when the outer teacher sees those covert signals in the student's 8th level instruction work, he knows that he needs to start working on the student in order to find out what they're doing wrong and fix that quick. Because if those problems aren't discovered and fixed quickly, the next step is that the inner teacher will shut down the student's internal esoteric environment, the operating environment in the sidereal universe. The student will one day go in to start to do the next exercise that he's been instructed to do, and nothing works properly. The environment doesn't look right. When you call up intelligences in order to interact with them, they don't arrive. When you attempt to fix the situation by carrying out the fix-it protocols, they don't work. And then you suddenly realize, after 3 or 4 attempts at running sessions where nothing is working properly, you suddenly realize you've been shut down from the inside out. This is not the outer teacher that's doing this, it's the inner teacher, and they actually have the ability to do that. They are the key holders. They guard the doorway into higher experience and higher knowledge. And this is another one of the main reasons why I absolutely insist that there is no such thing as self-initiation. Because without the cooperation of the inner teachers as a collective, what we call the invisible college, without their cooperation, you can't get safe, accurate, productive knowledge and conversation with the higher genius. They are the guys, those internal teachers, who hold all the keys to all the doors that lead to safe and effective knowledge and conversation with the higher genius. So, level 8 of training, this is the thing that the tutor is looking at. The student is taking each of the 7 exercises in level 8 and just carrying them out as by rote virtually, because he has no idea really what's going on. He just gets the instruction, do this, carries it out, isn't sure entirely about what the results of those exercises will be. But the teacher is looking at the results of those exercises and is analyzing from them what is happening in the student's psyche, whether or not the student is carrying out the instructions properly and is actually making headway, at the very least is maintaining a safe practice. At the same time, the outer teacher is also looking for indicators that something might be going wrong, that the student might be misbehaving in some kind of a way, and that signals are coming through from the internal environment to point that out. The outer teacher needs to then recognize that if it's happening, and then advise the student on how to modify their behavior in order to not end up being shut down. So that's largely what I wanted to talk about here in podcast 39. That the next stage of training after the Guardian on the Threshold is all about learning to access the higher functions, learning to access super evolved intelligences who can not only, in a verbal kind of a way, provide you with information which is super helpful to you, because you don't have access to that information normally yourself, and maybe even your teacher doesn't. But these higher intelligences, such as your higher functions, Neshama, Chia, Yakida, and your inner teacher, they have access to that extra special level of knowledge that you need in order to advance yourself towards the summit of this whole training process, which is knowledge in conversation with the higher genius. So the outer teacher is introducing you in this next stage, exercise 7, exercise 8, to those higher functions, showing you how to interact with the higher functions safely and productively, and how to get effective feedback from those higher functions that will help you surf your way up to the top of the summit of the initiatory process, which is knowledge and conversation with the higher genius. And then if something goes wrong during that process, the outer teacher attempts to use his skills to help you fix that problem. And most people during the eighth stage of training will have a number of functional problems with dealing with higher intelligences that the teacher will, the outer teacher will have to help them fix. That's just par for the course. But some students, about a third of students, will actually start misbehaving. They'll start to realize that they're getting real close to finishing this process, because after level 8 there's only two more processes in order to get to knowledge and conversation with the higher genius. And there are a number of people who are secretly hiding the fact that all they want out of this whole initiatory thing is control. They themselves want control. They have no intention of handing control over to their higher functions in order to live a more productive and spiritually orientated life, instead of a life which is completely orientated around mundane success. So they start to misbehave. They think, oh, I've got a handle on this whole thing, I'm two steps away from completing it now. And so they just start not carrying out techniques properly. They start being dishonest to their teachers about how they're carrying out exercises, and then things start slowly falling apart. So from the teacher's point of view, stage 8 in the training process is very much like the last level of vetting of students. It's like the last couple of miles in a marathon, where you have to pull together all your resources, all your training and experience, in order to make it to the finish line. And that's what access to the higher functions is all about. Of course, on the other side of the eighth stage, when you go to the ninth stage and the tenth stage, you look back at what happened at level 7 and 8, and you realize there was a lot more going on there than just the struggle to behave properly and manage higher forces more effectively. There's also a ton of knowledge in there that you were being provided with, that at the time, because you were struggling with focusing on technique and behaving yourself, that the actual knowledge that was being presented to you, a lot of it goes over your head. But because we insist on keeping detailed and accurate reports, all students have to keep detailed and accurate reports of everything that they do, then they have an accurate record to go back to in later months and years to re-look over the various stages of their own journey and be able to extract from those records deeper things that were actually going on there. So even after you reach knowledge and conversation and the initiatory part of the journey is actually over, you still have this massive resource of records that you kept and experiences that you went through that will keep affecting your life for years ahead as resources for very serious learning experiences when you look back on what was happening to you that you didn't realize at the time because you were just a new guy struggling through the process. Okay, so that pretty much is what I wanted to talk about here in podcast 39. That the third stage of the work is largely getting your first access to higher intelligences and learning about what they're all about and what interacting with them accurately is really like, because most people don't know that. A lot of people in mainstream schools kind of superficially interact with higher intelligences, but they have no idea what it's like when you do it properly. The kind of energies that you come into contact with and the quality of information, the quality of knowledge and understanding that you come into contact with through accessing these higher entities. This quality of experience is something which, up until now, in modern times, has largely been the possession of a very small handful of people in the world. And we're now entering a stage in human development where the ability to access this long hidden, this underground stream of knowledge, we're now at a stage in human development where a door is opening and is offering us the privilege and opportunity to get access to this very advanced an extreme level of human and superhuman experience. Okay, so the next podcast I make is probably going to be the last one in this series on Hermetic initiation, because it's going to deal with the ninth level of Heridim's training and then the 10th level, which is knowledge and conversation with the higher genius. There's not a lot to say about the 9th level because it's another check balance. It's one session for most people, sometimes two or three, but it's a very short experience. And the big thing though is what I'm going to explain about what happens at the 10th level, the summit of the journey, when you get your first access to your higher genius and what actually happens during that experience, and also to a certain degree how that experience is accessed by a properly trained student. And then I'll finish up the next podcast with a little bit of a rundown on what happens after that 10th level. Once you achieve knowledge and conversation, what do you then do with it? And that's an important thing to discuss because most people don't even think about that. Anybody who's been involved in Western Hermetism for a good deal of time and knows about knowledge and conversation with the Holy Guardian Angel or the higher genius, as we call it, and they really want that experience and they're hunting for ways to do it and they're practicing all kinds of techniques that will help when they put it all together to take them into that experience. Most people only think of getting that experience, their first knowledge and conversation with the higher genius. Very few people think about what will I do with it or what am I allowed to do with it once I succeed in that attainment, and how that actually works in real time practical life has very little to do with what most people believe it is all about. So at the end of the next podcast, I'm going to talk about that to a certain degree too. What happens once you've finished initiation? What happens once you have access to your higher genius? How it affects most people who get there. So for now, I hope the next several months, possibly even the next year, that you all stay safe and that you don't lose your way in your spiritual journey while you're being encouraged by the authorities in your country to panic and put all of your focus on your material existence. I hope while you're all going through that process that it doesn't ruin your spiritual journey. In the middle of all of this, don't forget about the hermetic view of life. That we believe, that Hermetism teaches, and that we believe that physical life is not governed by physical powers, nor by your incarnate personality. That physical life is governed by higher powers, higher energies, higher intelligences. Everything that happens here in this world is governed by higher intelligences that are ultimately beneficial in nature. This is one of the ground bed beliefs and teachings that Hermetism has taught for thousands of years. Physical reality is governed by higher intelligences, and that if we want to have a more successful life, the first thing we have to do is learn to safely and accurately have an intimate relationship with those higher intelligences. And it's a good thing to remember over the next several months or possibly a year. So again, Godspeed to you all. And let's hope that the next podcast isn't too far away. We'll be singing when we're winning. We'll be singing again.